Sorry. Everybody, thank you for coming this afternoon. Before we get started, Congresswoman Anne from the 18th District of California is here to welcome and say a couple words. She's been a member of Congress since 1993. She's been a champion and a forceful advocate on telecommunications issues, consumer protection issues, and net neutrality for her tenure during Congress. She's also the co-chair of the Congressional Internet Caucus. So I'm going to hand it over to her before we get started.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. How are you? Repeating. Have food, people will show up, right? Thank you for coming today. Thanking you for being here to acknowledge and thank Senator Ed Markey, who's going to be arriving shortly. You should know that he is more than a partner and a pal on the Energy and Commerce Committee before he came to the Senate. So for those, how many are here for the Senate? How many from the House? Senate? The rest of you are House staffers. It's great. Well, you're all most welcome. At any rate, Senator Markey, myself, and public knowledge, here comes Senator Markey. It's great to see you, Ed. Great to see you. Good to be in the same room with you again. I want to welcome and thank Chip Pickering, who heads up INCOMPAS, Chris Lewis from Public Knowledge, Melanie, Wyne from National Association of Realtors, John Sallet, who's a senior fellow at the Benton Foundation and former FCC General Counsel under Tom Wheeler, Rachel Wolbers from Engine, and Lauren Culbertson from Twitter. Now, why did we think that this would be a good idea? Because one of the best ideas that's ever been created in the history of humankind, an American invention, the internet, and all it represents is actually at stake right now at the Federal Communications Commission. Now, some history is going to be given by panelists about where the effort began in order to protect an open, accessible internet. You are going to get this is a deep dive for you to be inoculated with the best information, and I'm not going to be the one that imparts it to you. But why is it important? Why is it important? What is at stake for the member that you work for and the people that member represents? Well, there were some 40 million people that weighed in with the Federal Communications Commission. That's historic. There's never been that many Americans that have actually taken the time and the trouble to contact a federal agency about something in the history of our country. And amongst that 40 plus million is your members' constituents. And they use the internet. They know. So there are forces that want to change it according to your business plan. We believe that we're here. We respect business plans. We know that we want a business to make money. But overall, we are responsible for the common good of our country, for the public interest. So I think that today's presentations, these are the pros. The best are here, really. And Senator Markey certainly underscored that. But this is a Herculean effort, and it's a major battle relative to the future of the internet in our country. I've been a staffer. I know who comes into the offices. We know. They're familiar interests. Donated to campaigns, you hear from them and see them, they're nice people that come in and whatever. But this is a really overarching view of not only what we have enjoyed, what we want to protect, and why we need to protect it, and the interests that the constituents that elected your boss, the stake that they have in it. So that's why your presence is so important, and that you're going to be equipped, you're going to be armed with the absolute most factual information to talk to your member about. And even though you can't, the comment period is closed, we're going to start watching this thing real closely, because you're going to feel that you, yourself, your family, your friends, have a huge stake in this as well. So I'm going to turn the mic over to, Congressman. He's been a congressman, and now he's a United States Senator. There isn't anyone in the entirety of Congress that knows as much, has done as much, in the telecommunications, internet space in the United States Congress than Senator Ed Markey. I count him as one of the best friends I have in my life, but certainly one of the most distinguished, I think the most distinguished, now in the Senate, I would still say the entirety of the Congress of the United States, Senator Ed Markey.
See why I miss the House of Representatives. People don't talk that way in the Senate. Anna has said my telecom teammates throughout all of these battles over all of the years to get us here today. And there's no one who fights for this, no one who fights for competition longer. And more ferocity than Anna, and that's what we're trying today to continue to ensure that we protect and that we advance. So Anna and I have been kind of partners on this since 1994, since before the Telecom Act was passed. For this incredible explosion, and try to ensure that these new technologies are animated with the values, with the rules, with the perceptions that allow for consumers to be benefited, and for Darwinian paranoia inducing competition to be unleashed, because every voice, every idea has access to the internet, and that they're able in an unfettered way, without being tipped upside down and having money shaken out of their pockets unnecessarily, to be able to reach a market of 320 million Americans and then beyond. So that's really what we've been all about right from the very beginning, and that's why it is great that we've got this all-star cast, which has been gathered, because now we're coming down to the fourth quarter. We're coming down to where we're going to have to organize and not agonize about this battle that we are coming near the conclusion of, at least in this phase, because it could go on and on depending on what does happen at the Federal Communications Commission. So I want to thank Phil Berenbroick for moderating this discussion. We thank you for being here in our all-star lineup. Chip Pickering, Chris Lewis, John Sallet, Melanie Wyne, Lauren Culberson, and Rachel Wolbers. So we thank all of you for being here, because it's your broad range of bipartisan views that has always been at the heart of animating debates about telecommunications policy. They've always been inherently bipartisan. We've always been trying to take technology and to deal with it in a way that teases out partisanship. And that's what underscores the broad support for the open internet order across the entire country. The people who are here are the net neutrality pioneers. They're warning that the broadband barons are coming, trying to shut down the open architecture which is baked into the personality of the internet. It always has been. But in the Trump administration, there is an effort now to upend this hallmark of American innovation and democratization of access by gutting net neutrality protections. The basic principle of net neutrality is that all internet traffic is treated equal. It applies the principles of non-discrimination to the online world, ensuring that the broadband providers do not block, slow down, censor, or prioritize internet traffic. Net neutrality creates a level playing field where the best ideas, not merely the best funded ideas, can thrive. But Chairman Pai and the broadband industry want to turn back the clock so just a handful of gargantuan companies can pick online winners and losers. And if they have their way, ISPs will be allowed to set up internet fast lanes for those with the deepest pockets and internet gravel paths for those who cannot pay top dollar. And all of those extra charges will eventually be passed on to consumers. No one should have to ask for permission to innovate. But without net neutrality protections, that's precisely what an entrepreneur will need to do in the future. That's why 22 million people have had their voices heard at the FCC, and they all have a clear message to Chairman Pai: put down your weed whacker. Just put it in the closet. You don't need to use it. This is a system that is not broken. Massive investment in software and internet-specific companies. Massive investment by the broadband companies in infrastructure upgrades. It is a job creation engine unknown in the history of America or the planet. It's not broken. It's working like the engine of growth, which it is supposed to, and the engine of democracy, which it is turned into. So, from my perspective, today is an incredibly important day. We're kicking off this fall season with an effort to try our best to send a message to the FCC that the American people do not want to see this change. So let me turn it over to Phil and ask you now to take over and moderate this all-star panel. Thank you. Thank you all so much for all being here. Thank you.
Congresswoman and Senator, thank you for the your remarks. Thank you for being with us today. Thank you, everybody who came. Thank you for joining us. I'm just briefly going to introduce our panel. But before we get started, again, thank you for coming. Thank you for joining Public Knowledge. For those of you who aren't super familiar with us, Public Knowledge is a DC-based think tank, public interest and consumer advocacy organization. We work on issues ranging from telecom and technology policy, media consolidation issues, and intellectual property. We do so at the intersection of competition and consumer protection. Hopefully some of you know us, and hopefully we get to know the rest of you who we aren't that familiar with yet. And I just want to, for those of you who are online and want to either live tweet or who need access to the event, if you're not a staffer and don't have access to the Senate, Wi-Fi network. If you're using the Senate guest network, the password is resolution, all lowercase. And if you're going to live tweet, we have a hashtag for the event. It is FCC rules, all one word. So that's sort of a little bit of housekeeping before we get started. So we're going to talk about what net neutrality is a little bit. Some of you guys are might not have been around. Going back to the 96 Act, like Chip was. So we're going to talk a little history. We're going to talk about what's going on right now and what your bosses might be interested in knowing. The context for this is in 2015, the FCC, after about a decade of looking and doing some sort of neutrality rules under bipartisan FCC leadership, initially during the Bush administration, and then eventually during the Obama administration, adopted a set of open internet rules. Those have been in effect since June of 2015, initially adopted in February of 2015, and then in May of this year, the new FCC leadership introduced and adopted a notice of proposed rulemaking that will roll back those open internet rules. So that's sort of the world we're living in right now, where we have rules on the books, but there's a proposal to roll them back. So I'm going to throw it to our panelists. Introduce them down the line. The first person I'm going to toss it to is Chip Pickering. He's the CEO of INCOMPAS. They're a competitive telecom provider trade association. Prior to that, he was a congressman from Mississippi working with the House Energy and Commerce Committee. And before that, he was a staffer for Senator Trevon, where he was instrumental in helping write the Telecom Act of 1996.
Well, thank you very much. It's good to be here. As was mentioned, I was a former staffer, and then I became a member, and I lost all my power and influence. And so I appreciate the role that each and every one of y'all play. This is a great time to address fundamental questions about what the future of telecom and technology and internet policy will be and should be. And I'll give you a little bit of background of who we are and the INCOMPAS. Why we advocate what we advocate, and what it means to the economy. And then I look forward to hearing the rest of the panel and answering any of your questions. But INCOMPAS represents, well, let me step back. INCOMPAS is the founding association, the first association advocating, going back to 1981, for competition in telecom markets. None of y'all are old enough. We used to just have one telecom company for the environment. And you used to just have one cable provider in every city. So all of those monopoly policies that were prior to your birth, probably in the mid-80s and then in the early 90s, have been changed and replaced with competition laws. And at the very heart of net neutrality over the internet is competition. It is the hard result of competition policy. Second, historically it has been bipartisan, and it should still be bipartisan. And we'll talk a little bit about what unites all Americans behind the principles and the concepts of an open internet and free internet. It is the most pure free market there is. So I'm a Republican. And if you look at what it means on net neutrality, no blocking. Same as in free trade policy, we're not going to have a barrier to entry. No throttling. We're not going to treat commerce differently. We're not going to slow some down and speed some up. Everyone has equal access to the market. And because of that, there are no distortions, there's no corruption of the market. It is, as a Republican, the best, purest form of a free market. And that's why in the early days, as I was just becoming a member of Congress in 1997 to 1998, and I was the chair of the subcommittee that oversaw the transition of the internet from a public research and defense network to the commercial internet that we now know. The first chairman of the Bush administration, as the internet began to emerge, was the first one to adopt net neutrality as a policy. The second Bush chairman of the FCC was the first one to enforce those policies and those laws. Anna and Ed were here in 2006. We worked together to codify net neutrality principles, and we got nearly 400 votes in the House to do so. It did not make it through the Senate. If you all know, the Senate moves a little bit more slowly. Elections changed the next year. We had a huge bipartisan consensus just a little over 10 years ago around net neutrality. The world has changed a little bit, and as we see the partisanship, the divisions today, remember that net neutrality and open internet started as an American consensus. And this is the important thing. Where Washington may be divided on this issue, we conducted a poll with Compass earlier this year. and 80% of Americans, equal Republicans, equal Democrats, equal Trump voters, support the principles of net neutrality. If you ask the question, do you want your internet to be more like your cable service or more like the internet as it is today, it's overwhelming. Again, 80-20, they do not want it to be like cable where you have basic or premium or different access and different prices based on different content. And so there's an overwhelming majority of Americans. You'll hear from Melanie, this has now become not just an ISP or infrastructure versus Silicon Valley issue. Realtors and mainstream businesses depend on the internet and having equal access to each of their customers or clients to be able to compete in a marketplace. And for a realtor or a hardware store or a mainstream business, they overwhelmingly want to keep an open and free internet. So what has happened over the last 2 to 3 years after the 2015 order was adopted? We also asked the question, is your internet service today better than it was 2 years ago? Now you could ask, is the country going, and Ronald Reagan once asked in his famous debate with Jimmy Carter, is the country better off today than it was 4 years ago? If you ask that question today, you're going to get mostly wrong track answers. But if you ask, is your internet better today than it was 3 years ago? And 70% of the country believes that today said that the internet, after the 2015 order was adopted, is better today than it was 3 years ago. There's one thing that unites Americans both in principle and in practice, is that the open internet is working. So what is happening in the market since the order was adopted? We're seeing, and we represent INCOMPAS, we have something distinct. We have all of the leading internet companies, streaming and over-the-top companies, but we also have the leading backbone companies, leading business providers, the heartland companies like Windstream that are both incumbent and competitive. We represent both infrastructure and internet. And so what we're seeing in the marketplace are three things. One, the streaming revolution. Investment by not only Netflix, but now Amazon, Apple, Microsoft, Facebook, and new original programming content, making both traditional video better and new over-the-top streaming, high quality at a lower price and more accessible. So one, streaming revolution, tremendous investment and innovation. Two, we're seeing a business revolution. The cloud-based services that are dependent upon networks and over the and software design networks and open internet principles is also seeing a 40% increase in just 2015 to 2016. So businesses that are now using internet-based services, applications, software, and cloud-based services is exploding. We just came back from our annual conference in San Francisco, and we also represent the new fiber network. And then the small cell and the wireless new competitors. And what internet, the open, abundant internet is doing is driving new networks and investment in new networks at an unheard of rate. And that all has happened over the last 2 or 3 years. The policy is working. It is not broken. It is bipartisan. It is both the free and the equal principles that make it not just a Republican or Democrat, but an American issue of consensus. So as we go forward, our job is to protect and preserve them, hopefully convince the FCC to stand down in their actions, and to find a consensus of how to preserve them. And I look forward to y'all's questions as we go forward the rest of the day.
All right, thank you. Next we've got Melanie Wyne, or Wyne. That's what I thought. Melanie Wyne, she's the Senior Technology Policy Representative at the National Association of Realtors. She works with Congress and federal agencies on technology policy and the real estate industry. She's also a mentor to startup companies that work to enter the real estate space through the National Association of Realtors Technology Incubator. And I think she's going to talk a little bit about the importance of net neutrality to brick and mortar companies.
All right, thank you. So the National Association of Realtors, we have 1.3 million members in every congressional district in the country. And what's important to know about our membership is that the vast majority of our members are actually very small businesses. We do also represent the very large Century 21 and the large real estate companies that you've heard of, but the vast majority of real estate businesses are 1- and 2-person businesses. And the other really important factor to the net neutrality debate is that realtors are content creators on the internet. And they absolutely today rely on the internet to gain access to their consumers. So for that reason, NAR has had a policy on net neutrality for several years. We supported open internet rules. We see the rules that are currently in place as ensuring that all companies, no matter what size, the very smallest to the largest, so that really encompasses all of our members, have equal access to their consumers on the internet. And it's exactly this kind of access and competition that's the engine of the American economy. So our concern, we're concerned about rollback of the rules that might allow for throttling or blocking, or really the concerns my members the most is the prioritization, having to pay internet service providers to get access to their customers. So that's really the big risk that we're afraid of, and again, sending the message that this isn't just a Silicon Valley versus infrastructure issue. This really impacts Main Street businesses, because today everybody's an internet business, and it's that open, free internet that gives Main Street businesses access to consumers. Thank you.
Thanks, Melanie. Next up is Laura Culberson. She works on public policy at Twitter. She has a diverse background where she's worked in politics, on statewide campaigns, on Capitol Hill, and in the private sector. She's based here in Twitter's Washington office, and she represents the company that centers on public policy issues here on the Hill and in the administration. Laura.
Thank you, Phillip. Hi, everyone. It's good to be here with you today. I first came into this issue about 2.5 years ago. I've worked in Republican politics since I graduated from college. I started with a coalition of tech startups to share the small business voice. If you go talk to startups and virtual campus too, they'll tell you one of the number one things that keeps them up at night is the lack of net neutrality, because they realize that very quickly their business could be upended by one and by an internet service provider. And so why does Twitter care about that, right? We're a larger company now, but we realize that without net neutrality principles, it's very possible we couldn't be what we are today. Today we have 1 billion tweets every 2 days, and to give you a little snippet from our day of action, where we call on people to voice their concerns about the proposed rules, the rollback of rules by the FCC, we saw 400 million tweets in 24 hours on net neutrality. So not only is our platform, is net neutrality important to our platform, but we're very happy that it's also facilitating this conversation, an open conversation on this issue. So we believe this is one of the most important free expression issues of our time. Again, we're an open platform, and we welcome and we encourage a free flow and open form of ideas and expression. And as you guys know, this, your members, we have 100 senators who are on our platform, and almost every single House member is there. So you guys understand the importance of your boss being able to get their message out to their constituents. And without net neutrality, that could be at risk. We also care about net neutrality because it's so important to economic growth, as I talked about. It's possible Twitter wouldn't be Twitter without net neutrality. But the amount of data and the amount of activity that our platforms are facilitating actually increase the need for investment. So it's a virtuous circle, right? We are creating more demand for the internet service provider product. So I think that's something to think about when you're looking at all arguments in this debate. And then finally, one thing I want to hit on is the safety aspect. On our platform, in the last, I think that would be September now, during the recent hurricanes, we saw something that I was really just taking back by and really moved by, frankly. When some of the traditional emergency service providers and So when Hurricane Harvey hit East Texas, you saw a situation in which 911 services weren't prepared to adequately handle the volume, and so people turned to platforms like Twitter and Facebook to cry out for help. And we essentially became a supplement to civic infrastructure. This is something we didn't anticipate, but it happened. And a group of ordinary citizens created a Google Doc, and they started cataloging all of these different requests for help. And as a result, we estimate between 5,000 and 10,000 people were rescued based on that operation, which is a really moving thing to see happen. But this happened organically. This happened through these platforms. So my point is, you never know where the internet is going to foster something really important. And without net neutrality rules, a situation like this, it could have been stopped, it could have been slowed down, and lives might not have been saved. And so these are other considerations that I would encourage you to think about and that are very important to it's a very important reason why we need to ensure strong net neutrality rules. And I will kick it off to the next person.
Thanks, Lauren. Next up is Rachel Wolbers. She's the policy director at Engine, which is a nonprofit organization that advocates on behalf of startups on policy issues and promotes startup ecosystems. Previously, she was legislative director at Twin Logic Strategies, which is a bipartisan, all-women tech lobbying firm. And prior to that, she was the judiciary committee portfolio LA for Congressman Lloyd Perrin from the House. And I'll throw it over to Rachel.
Thank you. So I'm glad I get to go after all my fellow Republicans on the panel as well. So I'm somewhat new to this issue, even though I've had the work for Congressman Berenbroick, who is a Texas Republican member. We had not really worked a lot on the neutrality issues until I started with Engine earlier this year. And I admit that when I started at Engine, I was a little skeptical that net neutrality was so important to startups and that we had this real need for it until I started speaking startups all over the country. But I'm from Grand Rapids, Michigan, so I went home and talked to a lot of startups in Grand Rapids and asked them, what are some policy issues that you care about? How can we be helpful? Every single startup I've talked to since I started with Engine, their number one priority has been net neutrality. And it's been very eye-opening for me. So I've been thinking a lot and talking to them about why net neutrality is so important to startups. And it really is because the internet drives all of the different startups in our economy, and that includes healthcare and cybersecurity and education and manufacturing. They all have components of either the Internet of Things or data moving across their platforms and their networks. And so they understand how important it is to have this free flow of information data. So when you think about the net neutrality rules and why it's so important for these net neutrality rules, particularly for small businesses, think first, startups are really competing very fiercely for just a first chance with users, and they rarely get a second chance. So if their content is blocked or throttled, there are studies that show that even if your website takes an extra second to load, you are less likely to purchase something from the website or return to that website. So it's milliseconds that startups really get to make their case and to get your business and your eyeballs and create new consumers. So that's very important to them. The other thing that is really crucial is the paid prioritization issue. Most startups start with under $75,000 of investment capital. That's usually coming from friends and family. So for a startup to think that there might be new paid prioritization schemes, they know that they really won't be able to afford an additional cost or added expense clients to their business, and because they are many times competing with large companies, every dollar really matters. And so the threat of paid prioritization, it not only keeps them up at night, but it also decreases investment. Investors do not want to invest in companies that their regulatory framework could change. And so one of the great things about the open internet order was that it created bright line rules of the road that help increase investment, increase certainty in the marketplace, and allow all of our startups to compete on a level playing field. I'm happy to go into any deeper on any of those three issues, and I'm just really excited to be here and be chatting with all of you guys.
Great, thanks, Rachel. So next up is Chris Lewis. He's the vice president here at Public Knowledge, where I work, and he leads the organization's advocacy in Capitol Hill and other agencies. Prior to joining Public Knowledge, he served at the FCC as deputy director of the Office of Legislative Affairs, where he advised the FCC chairman on legislative and political strategy. He also was a former Senate staffer, so he's back in his old stomping grounds. He worked for the late Senator Edward M. Kennedy, and he has over 15 years of political organizing and advocacy experience. I didn't want to be informal in the Kennedy caucus. So.
That's fair. Thanks, Bill. That was really formal considering that I worked like 15 feet away from Bill. Thank you guys for all coming out. I just want to spend a few minutes talking about the consumer perspective, because I think it's central to this issue, and not only that, but, you know, all of the folks who have spoken so far, we as Americans, just average American citizens, use all their services. I use Twitter all the time. Realtors, essential to every community. And you can go down the line, and so there's a couple reasons why I think consumers are so passionate about this issue that I just want to raise up, and then, you know, I'm interested in getting into the Q&A. But number one, I want you to remember, is consumer choice. Most consumers, when it comes to access to the internet, have very few choices for ISPs, for truly high-speed broadband. Most consumers only have one choice for high-speed broadband. And there are some communities where they really don't have much of any choice at all for high-speed broadband. And it's not just the rural communities, although it is especially bad for rural communities. But even in Tampa Beltway here, where I live in Alexandria, Virginia, I have one choice for high-speed broadband. And so with that, the incentive that those companies have to lock the throttle, or even to have paid prioritization, can really reduce consumers' choices online. Consumers want to be able to pay for the internet and then have access to the entire internet and choose, make their own choices as to what they see and what services they use. They don't want that choice to be made for them because of a paid prioritization scheme or other efforts by the ISP to prefer content, oftentimes their own content, because we have their own content, over rivals, upstarts, small competitors. So that's consumer choice issue is really important. It keeps prices low for the services that you use online. And it's important to consumers that as the cost of cable and other connectivity goes up, that the services that you get access to online, that the cost for those services remains competitive and as low as possible. The second reason, I think, is even more important than consumer choice, and that's freedom of expression, which has been mentioned by some of the other panelists, but I think it's central to the concerns of average Americans, because the internet is a two-way network, it's two-way communications. And when your speech is slowed or degraded or discriminated against by gatekeeper ISP, it really reduces the options you have to express yourself. And that's important because broadband is essential for everyday life. It's essential communications in a number of ways. We all think about video and entertainment, and that's fantastic. We don't want to see discrimination. We want choices for entertainment. But when you think about essential things in your daily life, your education, the services that students need online. You want to have as many choices as possible. You don't want to see a ton of high school choosing what education services online are prioritized. That's essential to your daily lives. It's the same with access to jobs. Most people actually apply for jobs online, and so how you apply for jobs is important, and what services you choose to use to do that is important. Advocacy is huge. Whether you're on the left or the right, people are using tools like Twitter to organize and to advocate. They're using tools like Facebook to organize and advocate. And they have should have the ability to say, I don't want to choose Twitter, no offense, Lauren, or Facebook to organize, but that they to start their own or to use some other smaller competitor service that they feel like respects their voice, allows them to express themselves with their own voice, their own unique, independent voice in a way that's true to them. And so, yeah, that may be Twitter, that may be Facebook, maybe something else, but to hurt competition for those platforms that allow them to express themselves online is harmful to those essential needs that the internet provides: advocacy, education, jobs, we're seeing with healthcare, and then of course on the entertainment side. So that freedom of expression is central to the internet. It's how we've all understood it as it's developed, and we don't want to see that change by seeing these rules roll back. The last thing I'll say is. Phil mentioned I worked at the FCC, and so I've been around this issue for now three iterations of the FCC looking at it. And previous efforts have been important, and should mention some of them, but where they've all led up to the rules that we have today, because we had to find a way of protecting those values of non-blocking, non-throttling, paid prioritization in a way that is legally sound. And I'm so excited, and you hear more about this from our next panelists, that we've gotten to a point where these rules are legally strong and they've been upheld in court, and they're popular and they're working. And so, you know, we hate to see the uncertainty that comes from them being challenged when there's such consensus, broad consensus, that having open internet is important. And so, that uncertainty has been put in place by the FCC looking to roll back the rules. And so we encourage all of you to study this and to see how we can convince the FCC not to repeal or roll back the rules. And it will change the way, it'll take away the protections, that will change the way that people act and move on online. And that would be great uncertainty for businesses, but also for how consumers use those services online. All right.
Thanks, Chris. And last but not least is John Sallet. He's a senior fellow at the Benton Foundation and a partner in the Antitrust Competition and Telecommunications Internet Media Groups. It's a mouthful. We're at Steptoe & Johnson. Previously, and probably most famously, he was the general counsel at the FCC, and he led the FCC's defense of the 2015 Open Internet Order. Most recently, he was the Deputy Assistant Attorney General in the Antitrust Division of the Department of Justice. And in the 90s, he was in the Department of Commerce, where he focused on technology policy.
Thanks very much. Yeah, okay, thanks. So there's a joke that politicians, Chip probably used this joke. The joke that politicians tell, and your bosses may use it, right? You're the last speaker at, say, a political dinner, following a long line of speakers. So you stand up and you say, we've come to the moment in the program where everything that could be said has been said, but not by everybody. So that's the position I find myself in now. I'm going to just make three points, none of which are new, but just for emphasis. One, you should all understand that the 2015 order, the order now in effect, rests on a very strong legal foundation. I argued the Title II question in the D.C. Circuit, and the challenge to that order, the commission won, not because of my advocacy, but because the commission was right. When Congress amended Communications Law in 1996 and put in the definition of telecommunication services and information services, that's the technical question, they made plain that they were embodying in the law a policy. A policy to ensure that gatekeeper control of telecommunications networks did not thwart or distort competition in other markets. This was 1996. Those other markets were AOL, modems, online services, Prodigy. But the principle is strong today as it was then. In addition, the legal foundation is strong because the rules were based on facts that have only grown stronger then. And so, my own view is that the substantial legal risk that attaches to an attempt to overturn that order, and one would expect to see litigation that follows. Second point. One of the discussions that happened a lot from the 2015 order and since is the so-called virtuous circle. Right? So it's a very simple concept. Broadband providers may want to limit traffic on the broadband connections. But that's not actually in their own interest or anybody else's. Because the more traffic that goes, the more edge providers create content to the traffic. The more consumers want the traffic, the more they will use broadband. This will lead to more broadband investment. Now, it's not hard to see why broadband companies might get this wrong. When I was at the FCC, we reviewed three big telecom mergers that involved companies. Remember, the big broadband companies also are cable TV providers. I mean, description, right? So what one saw was that there was a tremendous incentive and ability to worry about broadband traffic, even to curb it, in order to protect the existing revenues of the video side. The virtuous circle is designed to make sure that doesn't happen, but also to make sure broadband companies are rewarded for the investment and deployment that they undertake. In fact, I think it's fair to say that in the summer of 2014, when the Commission was deciding what rules to adopt, what was so persuasive were the people who came in and said, look, I'm thinking about investing in a startup, an edge provider, but it will chill that investment if I don't know if the broadband provider is going to pick another company to be in favor and give it preferences. And therefore, the FCC worried that innovation from the edge would be lost. And it worried, and Chris has talked about this, about speech. The open internet and neutrality is not only about economics. It's also about democracy and diversity of views. And ensuring that there are not gatekeepers operating broadband networks, gatekeepers to speech, I think, particularly today, plays a fundamental role in democracy. Third point, people talk about antitrust. Well, who doesn't? People talk about antitrust and ask whether antitrust isn't a full substitute for the rules. So, a couple of months ago, Commissioner McSweeney from the Federal Trade Commission and I wrote an op-ed that was online through Wyne. And look, she is an antitrust enforcer. We're both alumni of the Justice Department's antitrust division. And what we said was this. Look, we both strongly believe in antitrust enforcement. It's a very good thing. But let's not misunderstand how it works. And we went back to a case that Anthony Kennedy wrote to the Supreme Court. When the Supreme Court reviewed the requirement that a cable system carry local broadcasting. And I want to just read you what he wrote. He said, regulation would be preferred to antitrust because he said, the quote, considerable expense and delay inherent in antitrust litigation and the great disparities in wealth and sophistication, quote, in that case between TV stations and cable companies. Well, that is even more true here. Right, an antitrust rule would say that a consumer, for example, would have to mount an antitrust challenge in private case or persuade an antitrust enforcer with far too limited resources to bring an antitrust case. That would be difficult for many reasons, and I could go into the doctrinal purposes and the reasons, but the fundamental point is it would tell consumers they had to bring to court very big broadband companies or force an investigation that led to a formal court action. What Commissioner McSweeney and I concluded was that this kind of disparagement helps demonstrate why the open internet rule is now in effect. Made sense in 2015, makes sense in 2017, and will make sense in the future.
Thank you, everybody. That was a lot of detailed background, helpful to sort of understand where we're coming from, where we're going, what the objections are right now. So we panelists mentioned, to varying degrees, the three bright line rules, the no blocking rule, the no flop throttling rule, the no game prioritization rule. There's also a fourth set of rules. There's a general conduct rule, which gives the FCC some flexibility to look at threats to the open internet and anti-competitive behavior that might not have been contemplated by the three bright line rules. So just kind of Melanie and Rachel, I wanted to pick your brain on this. There's a possibility, and I think the general conduct standard was set up to address behavior that if I'm an internet provider, if I'm a broadband provider, I might have some business incentive to engage in, but might not be covered under the bright line rules. Is that general conduct standard that gives the FCC that flexibility critical for Main Street businesses and for startups? Why is that an important protection as well?
I would say yes, for the same reasons that the bright line rules are important. It's just that, essentially, the answer is, we like the way things are working today. We think it's working well under the rules that are established today. And we want to see that continue to go forward.
Yeah, one thing I would add is that, as we're going forward, the startups that we work with, they are revolutionizing the way that we are communicating with people and conducting business, and where we're going to be 5 years from now is totally different from where we are today. And so while there are those great bright line rules, the way that the Internet of Things, that your pacemaker is going to communicate with your doctor, and the way that your cars are going to be, there's all this new forms of communication that are going to happen on the internet. And so making sure that the FCC can adapt to all of the new innovation that's happening that we see with startups across the country in all 50 states is really important for startups going forward.
Staying on the general conduct rule very quickly, Chip, I know INCOMPAS has been very active in the FCC's neutrality proceeding, and some of the comments that INCOMPAS has emphasized are the importance of interconnection policy, which I think probably falls under the general conduct standard as well. Can you sort of just briefly explain what interconnection is, why it's important, and the role it plays in the debate and the importance to INCOMPAS members?
So if you think about interconnection, it is the front gate to the last mile. And the end user is the last gate. So a lot of net neutrality is talking about making sure that the end user does not experience blocking or throttling or pay prioritization. Really, the reality is that most ISPs realize that would be so unpopular that they don't want to really change, or that they fear the political backlash of changing the end user experience. But at the front gate, they would really like to make the edge providers, the streaming companies, the realtors, the businesses that are creating content and sending them over the backbone, over the transport and transit, when they get to that gate, which is the equivalent, if you think about Houston or New Orleans or the great ports of our country, it's the point of entry to the market. What they want to do is to charge tariffs, tolls, access fees. Well, guess what? If you charge at the front gate, who pays for it at the back gate? And if you charge one company one thing at the gate and another company another thing at the gate, it undermines and sabotages the whole policy of an open internet. So from our perspective, interconnection to the end user, the rules should apply equally and without discrimination from point of entry to the end user. Interconnection in our experience from all of competition policy, at the heart of the 1996 Act, was interconnection. But now what do I mean by that? Wireless networks could connect with wireline. Cable networks could connect with telephone and vice versa. Electric utility networks could connect with each other. Competitive networks and backbone could connect with each other. We in the 1996 Act, as a nation, said we no longer will have any monopolies. And the solution to end monopolies is to make all networks interconnect. Well, an open internet from interconnection to interuser is the continuation of one of the most successful policies economically our country has ever known. So if you hear anything about not addressing interconnection, realize that without interconnection, that whole policy you think that you might could achieve to the end user could be lost at the front gate.
All right, thank you. So Chris, I'm going to throw to you for a second. You know, we've talked a lot about the benefits of the open internet, whether it's free speech, whether it's businesses trying to connect to consumers online or consumers controlling their internet experience. Part of the 2015 order was reclassification of broadband to being entitled to the communication service. Were there other benefits of that reclassification other than just the net neutrality rules we've been talking about here? Because I know that the NPRM that was adopted back in May would roll back that reclassification, not only the rules, but the reclassification. What were the benefits and what might be the implications?
That's a great question, because we heard earlier from John about the strong legal footing that the 2015 rules are on, and that legal footing is Title II of the Telecommunications Act. The FCC was really smart in applying Title II because of previous efforts to have open internet rules. The 2010 rules were basically thrown out because the court said if you want to have non-blocking and non-throttling, that those are common carriage or Title II-like protections. And so if you're going to do that, you need to be classified as a Title II carrier. The fact that the 2015 rules were upheld in court reflect the fact that they followed the court's instructions. With that, the FCC was very careful to say, okay, Title II gets us non-discrimination and all these great neutrality things, but are there things in Title II that should or should not apply to broadband? And sometimes they said, yes, there are things in there that should not apply to broadband. And so they had to use their power of forbearance to confiscate them to say these parts or these rules will not apply to broadband. Sometimes they said there are certain rules in Title II or parts of the statute in Title II that are important for communications networks. And so we will not forbear from them. Think of things like universal service. That helps us deploy broadband and ensure that everyone has affordable access to it. That comes out of Title II. There were rules like, if everyone remembers, the broadband privacy was so controversial and got rolled back at the beginning of this year. That was an instance when the FCC said, we think privacy is important. We don't want to apply it in the way that we applied it to telephone. So they forbore from the privacy rules that were for telephone and then created a proceeding to use Title II to create appropriate privacy rules for broadband. And we were big supporters of that. So there are a number of things that, that come with Title II that can be beneficial for the broadband age, and there's some that aren't, and we're glad that we have an agency that could be nimble and be an expert and apply the statute appropriately. And I think that's important that, you know, when you talk about the general conduct rule, it empowers the agency to use their expertise and use their nimbleness in a way that is helpful to consumers as technology changes so quickly and changes so rapidly in a way that Congress just can't keep up with.
So shifting a little bit to the 2017 NPRM, which the FCC adopted in May, John, I wanted to throw it to you and ask you, since you're the former general counsel of the agency, can you explain what was in the 2017 NPRM? What seems to be the motivating factors behind the analysis and the proposals in the NPRM? And where are we in that process?
Let me take them in reverse order. Where we are in the process, Congressman Eshoo addresses, the formal comment period has closed, but under SEC rules, the so-called ex parte is going to be filed up until about 7 days before an actual open meeting, and no open meeting has yet been set on this. So this is the moment in time when people who have views, have information, data, and analysis, can continue to give them to the FCC, and the FCC will continue to take them into account. Now, there's a lot in the NPRM, but I want to zero in on what I think is at the heart of it. I think it's paragraph 46, I might be wrong, but the commission says it believes that Title II depresses investment by broadband companies in their network. It calls that a predictive judgment in the NPRM. Well, there's two very important things I believe that are wrong about that. First, and Matt Wood is here, Free Press has really led the way in this analysis with just extraordinary analysis in great depth. There is actually no evidence that Title II has caused a decrease in broadband. In fact, the former chairman, Tom Wheeler, gave a speech in Chicago a few weeks ago, and with the aid of Free Press, pulled out a statement that AT&T had made some years ago in a different setting, saying, you know, you can't really judge much of the shift in capital expenditure, right? You spend money, and then you're getting an effect. You don't need to spend more. So I think the premise that we know that Title II is depressed in any investment is wrong. But second, just as importantly, an open internet rule is not designed to protect any single consumer. Not broadband providers, not edge providers, no single industry. It's intended to promote the public interest. And the bipartisan consensus up until this year that the FCC should have enforceable mechanisms keep the internet open, I think has stood the test of time and should be maintained so it continues to meet the test of time.
Thanks, and I think jumping off of the point that John just made about investment, I want to throw to Lauren and Chip and Rachel and Melanie. If you read the NPRM, there's a lot of discussion about claims of investment by the largest internet service providers. Is that the only metric we should be paying attention to, or is there other data points, other investment throughout the internet ecosystem that is relevant in this conversation?
We work with investors a lot. We work with a lot of venture capital companies and firms, and a lot of startups who are seeking an additional round of investment. And we've had VCs, great VCs, and Steve Scalise's district actually came up in one of our clients and talked about how they
were not considering investing in a number of content distribution platforms until after the open internet order passed, and they felt like there were clear and predictable rules for them to invest in a number of small startups in Louisiana that were creating new ways to share video and to have streaming services. There's a great startup that we work with in Grand Rapids, Michigan called Varsity News Network that has a platform for high school athletic directors to upload content and host blogs and do all sorts of interesting activities to promote what the high school athletic department is doing. And they said that they were only able to get their second series of investment after the open internet order had passed, knowing that the venture capital folks wanted to see that there would be these clear rules. And obviously some of this is anecdotal, but I think it's important to a larger point that these clear rules have allowed venture capital firms to invest more in smaller companies who want to take on much bigger services, right? They aspire to be the next YouTube, and you know, that's a great aspiration for them. But the only way they're going to be able to do this is if they can make sure that every dollar that they're spending is going towards their innovation and not towards paying tolls or being thwarted by larger ISPs who might also want to get into the same market that they're currently in.
And all of this activity isn't happening within a silo, right? Think about Varsity News Network that Rachel talked about. I'm sure they're probably looking at using Facebook and Twitter to direct traffic to their site. I like to use the example, some people might be getting these ads given kind of location and age. I bought a pair of shoes off Instagram the other day, right? So this is a startup that sells shoes, and the way that they're reaching their customers, so they're a smaller startup reaching their customers through Instagram. So think about all of the different things that had to work in order to make that transaction happen. I had to buy internet service, and so did Rocky's, the shoe service. And they had to get on Instagram, which if Instagram had to start in there with my Facebook, had to start paying for fast lanes to get their customer to this startup who's selling shoes, that could impede that ability. What Rachel said, if you have a scenario where it's taking too long to load an ad or a piece of content, that could potentially prevent a sale. And so there are a lot of different pieces here at play that a lot of times don't think about. We're just thinking startups, or big Facebook, Google, and or a little bit smaller Twitter. And so these things all work together. And so imagine a world in which you have to negotiate paid prioritization deals with all of these different components. It would create market chaos.
As we look at investment, there are layers and layers of investment. As you look at the Internet of Things and how it emerges, people are projecting trillions of dollars of value added to our economy. We're moving into a world where everything will be network dependent. Used to, we'd have one thing that would be network dependent, a phone call. And then it became data, email, and video, and now it's going to be telemedicine, it's going to be connected cars, it's going to be all your appliances, all your energy usage. Everything will be network dependent. Well, what happens if you lose open internet protections? And it is the biggest internet companies and the biggest ISP providers reaching agreements that shut out the startups and the competitive environment that we have today on all things that are all network dependent. So you could go to the real estate market, to Main Street, to selling shoes. I don't know if y'all ever watched Home and Garden TV, HGTV. Well, my hometown was discovered on a Facebook site, and now they have a show called My Hometown. And they're fixing up homes and they're bringing young couples and families and downtown of this small town is being restored. And so you have an example of, in Mississippi, of the internet bringing investment that no one could have imagined 20 years ago. So how do you quantify and qualify all the new networks that are being built? The software design networks, the Internet of Things.
You know, Netflix 2 years ago, before the order was adopted, was being, you know, held up, both hostage. Y'all remember John Oliver when he did his talk one night on the open internet, and he had the buffering of Netflix. Well, that was at the point of interconnection. These rules ended them. And if you talk to companies today, they're investing billions of dollars, whether it is Netflix or Amazon or Facebook or Apple, in new content. All of that is because they know that they have access without being held up at the front or the back gate of the internet. And the gates are open. Commerce is open. And it doesn't matter if you're a startup or a big platform company. And that is the beauty of an open internet and the current rules and how they're driving innovation and investment across all sectors and in all places.
And then lastly, on the, you know, the consideration that the FCC is giving to investment, Chris, has there been any consideration that you're aware of as of the user experience and the consumer experience, or is this just all focused on what big companies are doing?
We've largely seen the argument that the current FCC is making for all microphones of this around the last round. That's their central argument. And I think that's because, as I said earlier, just how popular the rules are. Only in DC, where you have large special interests that are attempting to lobby. That we have rules that protect the openness of the internet, but on a bipartisan basis, as we said earlier, the rules are popular. Folks want to maintain those protections, and since having current rules under Title II is the strongest way under the law to have those protections, it's why so many folks are passionate about keeping them.
And then the last question I had before, if we have any time, I'll throw it open to the floor for a couple of audience questions. I'd be remiss, we're here, you know, in the Russell office building. Every time I open up the Hill, I see an op-ed talking about legislation on net neutrality. I'll start with Chip, since he's sort of got a little more advantage here as a former legislator. Is this an issue that is going to be solved by legislation, or is it something that the FCC is going to do? What would that look like if it was a possibility?
Being from a congressional background, I would like to see the institution that I love actually set policy and to make it permanent. And so it is possible, and I think that there is a way that agreement that would preserve every single protection that the 2015 order, the bright line rules and oversight of interconnection and a good general conduct rule, if all of those protections are there, I think there's a willingness from many to come to the table and find a permanent solution. But it would have to be the same protections permanently protected by a congressional law and statute. And I think you could find bipartisan agreement if there were such an effort to enshrine what the 2015 order did.
Anybody else want to jump in on that?
I can just say, as a Republican who's worked on this issue for a few years now, when I started working on net neutrality, it was a very partisan issue. Chip mentioned, it used to not be. And so I'm really encouraged by the conversations that we're having with members and staff. I think the narrative has also changed to where people generally agree in these parts. We know they agree with them. They want a free and open internet in the rest of the world. But here in Washington, you see members of Congress on the Republican side talking about the importance of an open internet. So I think we're a lot closer than we used to be, and I just really encourage and I hope we will continue to have productive conversations.
So I'm probably not as positive as others. I think you're right when you say it's possible, but what discourages me are a few things. One, the movement of the FCC to roll back these rules is coming up so quickly, and they're expected to move in December, if they do, we will not have these protections. They will go away, and there's no sign. And so the second part is, there's been no sign that that I see is positive that Congress is taking any steps to fix that. And the 96 Act took 6-7 years to write. This is why you have an expert agency that creates the rules like they did in 2015. Because if you want to try and limit the law, Congress takes a long time to do it. And so while it's encouraging, I agree, to hear so many folks on the left and the right and on the Capitol saying that preserving open internet is important, I get concerned when I see congressional hearings that were called like they were in the House that only invite big companies, you know, big ISPs and big tech companies, and don't invite small startups or Main Street groups like the Realtors or consumers to the table to be a part of the conversation. That's not the right way to protect something that's important to all of us. And then that hearing didn't happen. So, you know, we haven't seen any legislation that protects the open internet in the way that the 2015 rules do, and that don't limit the power of the FCC to do its job as an expert agency and to be proactive and nimble with policy in the way that Congress can. And so that's why I'm discouraged, even though it's legally possible. I think the most important thing right now, given the policies that are on the Hill, is that we stop the FCC from moving forward with this rollback of the rules, because then we'll be without protections.
And let me just add, share Chris's agreement. If the FCC acts and rolls back, we'll be left without protections. And then what John is laying out, the legal case and the litigation and the uncertainty that would follow for years would be bad for everyone. So it'd be better to keep what is working, which is the current set of rules. If there is one day a consensus to move politically, on a bipartisan basis, legislatively, and with a process with everyone at the table, that would be ideal, but I don't know if we're there yet. We do know that the current rules are working, and those should be maintained, preserved, protected, until we do have the consensus to do something in Congress.
So we've got a few minutes left. We've got a microphone in the back. So does anybody have a question they wanted to ask?
In the back over there.
And then we'll come up here to you. Yeah, and if you can just identify yourself, that would be helpful. Thanks.
Hello? Okay, it's working. My name is Monica Dorhai, and I worked for about 7 years with the President of World Bank, Robert Zolli. And I have a PhD in anti-fraud and anti-corruption. And I was just speaking about this yesterday. I'm one of the internet hack people. My case is recorded with the Federal Communications Committee and with the Security and Exchange Commission. Again, Federal Communications Commission. And my name completely vanished from the internet. I have a degree from Harvard. There's nowhere. I have a degree from Michigan State. Nowhere. Duke. Nowhere. All my information vanished. And I'm also an international regulator. And it's even 3 months ago, there's no change. If you go post anything online, there's nothing. I know there is an issue of too much, but my name has vanished from the internet, and that's all. So that's my case, and it's still open. The internet doesn't generate anything under my name at all.
Does anyone have a response?
I'll just say, yeah. I don't know if that's a technicality concern, but you know, I know in public knowledge and a lot of us, we work on a broad range of broadband issues because while net neutrality is kind of at the core of the principles of the internet, to keep keep it open and allow folks to express themselves online as they see fit. There are other, concerns out there, whether it's privacy protection. You even see folks start talking about, how different large dominant platforms should work online. So there's a lot of questions out there. I don't know what would make someone's name disappear from the internet, but I think having an open internet does ensure that you have multiple outlets to choose from to publish and put yourself out there online. And without rules protecting that, it would be much more difficult.
And there was a gentleman up here who had his hand up earlier. Sorry, I'm making one of our legal fellows run from one side of the room to the other.
How you doing? My name is Sean Davis. I'm an Open Internet Fellow with the Center for Democracy and Technology. And my question was, since the comment period is closed, what are some steps that everyday citizens can take to help combat or fight against the rollback of neutrality?
I would encourage you to tweet.
The FCC is answerable to Congress. And so if it's clear that members of Congress are concerned about the direction of the rules, let's say you're more optimistic about legislation like Chip is than I am, if it makes sense to have the FCC slow down and stop what it's doing, so that if there was interest in having legislation, that can take form. But I think the biggest threat is rolling back the rules, and so asking a member of Congress to ask the FCC to stop what it's doing is probably the best thing you can do right now. And then there could be time to look at just how great the internet is working right now under the current rules, which we're concerned is getting lost in the discussion of the FCC when you have a chairman who has openly dismissed some of the views that are coming in from millions of Americans.
I think that's, we have one more over there and then we will wrap up.
Hi, I'm Ashley Goldup with Politico. You guys seem to think there wasn't really much momentum towards a legislative solution right now, towards the end of the summer and leading up to Congress coming back in session after August recess. There was going to be a hearing with the House Commerce Committee. I know some people, even on this panel, were invited and were maybe going to participate in that hearing. Do you know if that's ever going to happen or if that's still a possibility?
You know, at this point, there were efforts and discussions. It has grown quiet. It doesn't mean that there's not a willingness by all parties to try to find agreement. But at least at this point, there's no further action in those early discussions that were held this summer.
And just to quickly chime in and wrap up, I think one of the reasons why you've seen that process sort of disappear and wind down, any momentum that folks thought was generating towards that process happening, disappear. None of the folks on this panel were actually invited. None of the organizations, there are no organizations similar to us. Startups, consumer and public interest groups, civil rights groups, brick and mortar businesses, competitive providers, companies as large as, as Twitter that work in the internet ecosystem. None of us were invited. So that sort of, shows how serious that process was. I probably overstepped my bounds there as a moderator. I think that's all. I don't want to impose on our panelists, but if folks have any questions or want to follow up, I know that a couple people maybe might be able to stick around to chat if folks want to stay around and talk. Otherwise, thank you very much for coming. This was, a public knowledge event. You can find lots of information about Neutrality on our website. But again, thank you.